Hello everybody, I hope you're all well, and it's lovely to have you join us today for our morning prayer from the Vicarage. Hopefully you will have your Sunday worship booklet in front of you, and if you've been emailed you'll have had the readings for today. If you want to have the readings sent to you, if you just email me on rev.alex@btinternet.com, so it's rev.alex. all lowercase at btinternet.com, and if you give me your email address I shall send out the readings to you so you can follow along as well. So we're going to turn to the welcome and gathering prayer. Welcome in the name of Christ. God's grace, mercy and peace be with you, and also with you. Faithful one, whose word is life, come with saving power to free our praise, inspire our prayer, and shape our lives for the kingdom of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now we're going to have our first hymn, which is For the Beauty of the Lord. And the one I've picked this time is the one that has been put together by Rutter. It's a beautiful piece of music and it's got the lyrics on. So if you know it, please follow along. It won't take you long to learn it, I guarantee it. It's a really lovely hymn. So here we go, For the Beauty of the Earth. So there we did have For the Beauty of the Earth, and that was John Rutter's version of it, as I said previously. I'm now going to ask us to turn to our orders of service as we say sorry to God. We let fears control us. We let doubt become the way of life for us. If we but look, we will see our lives and our world cradled in God's loving hands. Let us confess our lack of faith, even as we trust the one who has promised to listen to our words as well as our hearts. Join me as we confess together, saying, forgive us, God of hope. Remind us that if we but open our hearts, you will heal us. If we but listen to your words, we will hear peace and joy. If we but open our lives to you, we can go forth to serve our sisters and brothers, even as we have been served by our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. With calming words and with a peaceful spirit, with overflowing love and hope, our God forgives us and fills us with faith. Our God affirms us for who we are, those whose brokenness is made whole, whose sin is forgiven, whose lives overflow with faith. Thanks be to God. Amen. And so we have our collect of the day. God, our Redeemer, you have delivered us from the power of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of your Son. Grant that as by his death he has recalled us to life, so by his continual presence to us, he may raise us to eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we also have Bishop Gregory's prayer for the virus. Dear Father, who created us and redeemed us, and who has promised us your love, be with us in a time of danger and of worry. May those who suffer or who are ill know the blessing of your grace, while we who are well be inspired by your Spirit to be wise and to be servants, looking for the healing and wholeness of all, each in our own way. Keep us calm and cautious, strong and open to service, so that we take care of those around us and also ourselves. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is from the book of Genesis, God's promise to Noah. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord, and took of every clean animal and of every clean bird, and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And when the Lord smelled the pleasing odour, the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground because of humankind, for the inclination of the human heart is evil from youth. Nor will I ever again destroy every living creature as I have done. As long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. The fear and dread of you shall rest on every animal of the earth and of every bird of the air, on everything that creeps on the ground and on all the fish of the sea. Into your hand they are delivered. Every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. And just as I gave you the green plants, I give you everything. Only you shall not eat flesh with its life, that is, its blood. For your own lifeblood I will surely require a reckoning. From every animal I will require it, and from every human being, each one for the blood of another, I will require a reckoning for human life. Whoever sheds the blood of a human, by a human shall that person's blood be shed. For in his own image, God made humankind. And you, be fruitful and multiply, abound on the earth and multiply in it. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, as for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again will there be a flood to destroy the earth. God said, This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth. God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." This is the word of the Lord. The New Testament reading is from the book of Acts. Then Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, "Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, 'To an unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you: the God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him. Though indeed he is not far from each one of us, for in him we live and move and have our being. And is even as some of our own prophets have said, 'For we too are his offspring.' Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, or an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will have the world judged in righteousness by the man whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Hear the Holy Gospel according to St. John. Glory be to thee, O Lord. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day you will know that I am in the Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. This is the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ.
May the word of my mouth and the thought of all our hearts be now and always acceptable in thy sight, my Lord, my Saviour, and my Redeemer. There is a fine line, I feel, between success and failure, and sometimes I wonder how close to that line St. Paul was with his style of evangelism. Yes, he does his preparation well, which is a golden rule of all preachers. He has walked around the city, mingling with, talking to, and listening to, and picking up on the concerns of the people, and even picking up on the type of religious language that they use. So he doesn't just use a set speech, but deliberately tries to pick up the world view of his audience. In the passage before today's reading from the Acts, we find Paul stuck in Athens, waiting for Silas and Timothy. But Paul, being Paul, he doesn't just take a holiday, but immediately throws himself into the fray, arguing and discussing with anyone who will listen, wherever they may be. And clearly this is down the street for the Athenians. Paul quickly gathers a crowd who are more than willing to join in a religious debate. They're like nothing more than a new religion, and politely invite Paul to come and address them about his ideas. Paul starts cautiously with compassion and compliments, saying he had noticed how religious they were, and then condemns them by saying they seem prepared to worship anything by putting up altars to nothing in particular, just in case. Throughout the address, Paul does a subtle mixture of flattery and criticism, building them up and then knocking them down again by telling them their altars were of little worth. Yes, he would agree that we all share a common humanity and a yearning for God, but then tells them that they are not perfect and they would need to repent and be judged. Paul is quietly building up to his climax here, which is the introduction of Jesus. This is something his audience are not quite ready for. Paul has recognised their religious instincts, but they prefer novelty and variety. They want to control God through the service they offer, and think this is best done by keeping their options open, by performing sacrifices at as many altars as possible. They are aware that all life is limited, and try to find their meaning by seeing themselves as part of the divinity. Paul understands this, but ruthlessly confronting them, he tells them that their lives do have meaning, and they will be seen in their entirety and judged by God through Jesus. But the Athenians weren't looking for that. They wanted affirmation, not responsibility. In particular, they didn't want to be judged by a God that they can't buy with worship. They wanted to bind God to themselves with the power and scope of their religious service. So Paul reminds them God is not to be bound. He is not to be bought. He is utterly free and needs nothing. He tells them they can't buy meaning and certainty with a rich variety of religious worship and observance. Having demolished their religious props, Paul now offers them Jesus, the one appointed by God and affirmed through the resurrection. He asks them to drop all their ideas and hopes and their sources of religious insurance and put their faith in one man. He tells them there's no easy way through religious observance or security, but only a hard way through repentance and the acceptance of limits. He tells them to believe this because God has shown it to be the truth by raising Jesus from the dead. to believe that God might focus all truth and meaning in one man, Jesus, is hard. Perhaps because many, like the Athenians, like novelty more than commitment. We like the idea of trying to control God more than giving God the control. We like the idea of our lives having meaning and not that the meaning is God's and not ours. In the reading from St. John's Gospel this morning, Jesus is telling the disciples about his resurrection and risen presence. He says they will see him because he will be alive, and they will be alive also. What he means is that they will be spiritually alive. At this moment, their minds would be all over the place and in a state of numbness, fearing a sense of impending tragedy. But the day will come when their eyes will be opened and their mind will understand and their hearts will be still. And they will see him as he really is. And that's what happened when Jesus rose from the dead. His rising changed despair to hope, and it was then that they realised beyond all doubt that Jesus truly was the Son of God. Amen.
And so thank you to the Reverend Marjorie Quinn for our readings and for Bill Harrison for our sermon today. We're going to turn back to our orders of service and we're going to say the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And so we now have Julie Price, who will lead us in our intercessions today.
The Intercessions for Irrigation Sunday. Let us pray to God the Almighty, the King of creation. God said, "Let there be light." Eternal God, we thank you for your light and your truth. We praise you for your fatherly care in creating a universe which proclaims your glory. Inspire us to worship you, the creator of all, and let your light shine upon our world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God said, "Let there be a firmament in the midst of the heavens." We thank you for the vastness of the universe and the mysteries of space. We pray for all scientists and astronomers who extend the boundaries of our knowledge. As we contemplate the wonder of the heavens, confirm us in the truth that every human being is known and loved by you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God said, "Let the waters be gathered together and let dry land appear." We thank you for the beauty of the earth, for the diversity of land and sea, for the resources of the earth. Give us the will to cherish this planet and to use its riches for the good and welfare of all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God said, "Let there be lights in the sky to separate the day and the night." We thank you for the warmth of the sun, the light of the moon, the glory of the stars. We praise you in the formation of clouds, the radiance of dawn and sunset. Save us from wasting or abusing the energy on which all life depends. Open our eyes to behold your beauty and our lips to praise your name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God said, "Let the waters bring forth living creatures and let birds fly across the sky." We thank you for the teeming life of the seas and the flight of the birds. Help us to protect the environment so all life may flourish. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind." We rejoice in the variety of animal life. Grant us grace to treat all animals with respect and care, to protect endangered species, to preserve the variety of habitats, and to honour the delicate balance of nature. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God said, "Let us create human beings in our own image." We pray for the human family. We exult in its diversity and giftedness. We repent of its sins, divisions, and violence. By the power of your Spirit, restore your image within us, through Christ who came to remake us by his death and resurrection. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, you have filled the world with beauty. Open our eyes to behold your gracious hand in all your works, that rejoicing in your whole creation, we may learn to serve you with gladness. For the sake of him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And so we continue in prayer by praying together the Lord's Prayer. As our Saviour taught us, we boldly pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And so we turn to our notices for today. First of all, I want to thank the anonymous gardener who's looking after the grass at St Mark's. When I nipped down there the other day, it had all been done again. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. It's great to see that the church grounds are being looked after. Secondly, as you know, I've had the April parish mags in the porch of the vicarage. And what I'm going to do is, because they're going to get sort of damp if I just leave them out there, and April's gone now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring them in the house. I'm going to keep the ones that have got people's names on, and then I'll recycle the other ones. So what I'll do is I'll put them back into the churches when we're allowed to go back into the churches again. So you'll still have your copy of the April parish magazine. And then what I'm going to do instead, and I'm going to do this on Monday, so they won't be available till Monday. But if anybody likes doing jigsaw puzzles, I've got about 5 puzzles that I've completed myself. So I'll put them in the box in the porch. So if anybody just wants one when they're doing their shopping or when they're going on their exercise, because obviously in Wales we're still under lockdown, please just help yourself to one of them. And if you've got any completed ones that you want to go into the box, the only thing I ask that people do is if they write if they are complete, if the jigsaw's complete, or if there's one or two people, bits missing or something like that. But I thought it might be nice to sort of like hand round jigsaws if we can get going on that. As I have mentioned for the last couple of weeks, but I'm just going to mention it again in case new people come on here or people who haven't had a chance to be in our other services. The Summer Fete has been cancelled for this year, but we'll get together as a fundraising group again when we are all back in church to sort that out. And also Emma and Leslie are well and truly, I think they're about a third way through now, their selection for provincial selection. So please continue to keep them in your prayers. I think they've got one more full interview before going on a day where they have to do a whole range of different things. But there you go. Please keep them in your prayers. We've got a couple of funerals coming up. We've got Edward Evans, and his funeral is on Tuesday the 19th of May at 11 o'clock. So if you could keep his family in your prayers, I'd be very grateful. And then Sheila Sweeney, her funeral is Wednesday the 27th of May, 10 o'clock at Northup. So please keep her family in your prayers. So the services that we've got for the next few weeks is on Wednesday mornings, we've got pray and chat. It was Thursday last week, but I had a funeral to do and I've got another one in a couple of weeks. But what we're going to do is somebody else will take over. So there might be a different Zoom ID, but it will still be on Wednesdays. We're going to just keep them Wednesdays at 10:30. On the 21st of May is an Ascension service, which we'll put together. There should have been a Borderlands one, so I'm going to find out what's happened to that in case it's a Zoom one and I can just share the Zoom thing and we can all go to it. But if not, I'll put a service together and put it on YouTube. And then the 24th of May, we've got a spiritual communion, which is from St. David's. So get your paperwork ready for that one. And then finally, Pentecost, we've got a missionary service for Pentecost, which is not just done as a missionary, but the bishop's involved in that as well. So that will be definitely one to look forward to. And I know there are people within our churches here that will be helping out with them. Right, so here we go. We've got the party popper because we're not in church. So this week's birthday is, there's only one, and it's a big birthday as well. It's Liz Tatum's 60th birthday. And of course, we keep her in our prayers. I'm going to pray for her in a minute. But I know that there was a few people last week that didn't have the party popper because I was in church. So Stephen, Liz's son, Bella and Robert Fletcher, this is for you as well, but mainly this week is for Liz Tatum, who's celebrating her birthday. Here we go. I'm sure they're getting more fierce. Hold on a minute, I'll see if I can go and collect the bits for you. There we go. That party popper's for you, Liz, and for all the rest of the people, but we're just going to pray for Liz now. Lord, we give you our thanks for Liz, for all that she does for the church and for the wider community. We give thanks for her and for her family. We pray that you would be with her. It's sad that she can't celebrate her birthday as she would have wanted to, but we just know, Lord, that you love her dearly. And we pray, Lord, that you would heal her from the illness that she's been going through over these last few weeks, Lord, and we just pray for that healing upon her. And we ask all this in the name of the Lord. Amen. There we go. So now we're going to have the peace, which I missed out last week. I think I completely forgot about it. So the peace of the Lord be with you always and also with you. And we share with each other a sign of that peace. And so now we're going to turn to our second hymn, which is a well-known hymn, Rock of Ages, Cleft for Me.
Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flow be of sin the double cure, save from wrath and make me the labor of my hands can fulfill thy law's demands. Could my zeal no respite know? Could my tears forever flow? These for sin could not atone. Thou must save and thou alone. Simply to thy cross I cling, naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace. Found I to the fountain fly, wash me, Savior, or I die. Wash me, Savior, or I die. I draw this fleeting breath, when my eyes shall close in death, when I rise to worlds unknown and behold thee on thy throne, Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself, let me hide myself, let me hide myself in thee. Let me hide myself. Let me hide myself. Let me hide myself in thee. Let me hide myself. Let me hide. Let me hide myself in thee.
Well, I'll be singing that all week now because I love that hymn. So shall we turn to our closing prayer? Eternal God, draw your church together into one great company of disciples, following our Lord Jesus Christ into every walk of life, serving him in his mission to the world, and together witnessing to his love on every continent and island. This prayer we make in Jesus' name, the source of all our life and love and peace. Amen. Go now and embrace the hope to which God has called us. Recognize Christ in friend and stranger. And as Christ has been gracious to you, so be gracious to those in need. And may God give you a place of rest on rich pasture. May Christ Jesus be the shepherd king who binds your wounds. And may the Holy Spirit give you wisdom and reveal to you the fullness of the one who fills all in all. Amen. And we say the grace together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Have a wonderful week. I'd like to thank Bill, I'd like to thank Julie, and I'd like to thank Marjorie for all their help today. And I'm going to leave you with a Taizé community piece of music. In the Lord, I'll be ever thankful. God bless. In the Lord.